As I had mentioned, that my area is in network security and cryptography. Over the years, these have has been. I mean, these are the some basic skills that you need to have as a security professional or researcher. But over the years, my interests have changed, have shifted towards not securing systems. 20 years ago, I did my PhD 20 years ago in cryptography, and yeah, I was really happy back then, very ambitious, hoping that I would contribute to the body of knowledge and make systems more secure. And after working also in the industry, I realized that no matter what we do, it doesn't matter how hard you try, the security is going to fail. Systems will fail. So security is about how you handle the failures, basically. And my area of research now is in digital forensics and incident response. And I will use a context of cities and smart cities, and because this is this ties very well with a few projects that we have been working on, funded projects, and some observations. So there's lots of observations. There will be some more concrete findings that I will present. But the overall context is smart cities. And in a minute, I'm going to talk about a particular type of smart cities, which is circular cities. So so let's quickly make sure that everybody is on the same page. It all started a long time ago. This is the first information system, or as you can guess, because information systems existed way before computers and computerized information systems. Actually, what we can say, this is the first, version zero of Instagram. This is the prehistoric Instagram, if you think about this. You know, some influencer who caught a mammoth, they wanted to make a big story out of it, and they captured that instance in some wall, in some cave, somewhere on the planet. But nowadays, we cannot even start thinking of not including computers and computerized information systems. We have to be crazy to do things. Some of the things that we're doing with computers, we have to be crazy to do them manually. But the main point of the computerized information systems is to be able to express real models as part of an algorithm. So these, what are these models? These can be natural models. It can be astronomical models, the stock market, economy, nature. You name it. Anything, you can express it through a mathematical model. Then you can import it in a computer, and then you can study it better using the computational power. So pretty much for many years, this was the situation. And then at some point, computers started getting interconnected. And as you can guess, this is an artistic representation of the internet. I think the green are the dot-coms, if my memory serves me right, because this is a very old representation. This is a very old drawing of the internet. It's more than 15 years old, because the internet doesn't look like this anymore. Yeah, you all agree that it doesn't look anymore. It has changed completely. Actually, would you like to see what the internet looks like today? It looks like this. So essentially, we're the internet, and this is where the socio-technical dimension comes in. We are the end nodes of the internet. We are, this is my phone, we're 24/7 connected, yeah? Which is quite sad. but what we do is we receive information. So the internet is mainly the channel, the communication channel, the communication medium. We receive information, we process information in our heads, and then we respond. So we are part of this huge socio-technical system that is made of computer gears and human gears. But it doesn't stop there. Nowadays we're talking about cyber-physical systems. Yeah, So cyber physical systems, we're adding a little bit more to the complexity. We did talk about computers being able to process data based on a mathematical model, on some model. But now, because of IoT, mainly IoT, which IoT, there are many definitions of IoT. My favorite definition is an IoT is a network device, some device with TCP IP stack, but it also has either or a sensor and an actuator, meaning that it senses, it can measure things happening in real life, and then they can influence, they can take decisions that can influence the physical, the real life. So we're talking about physical systems. So, and that's where the first problem comes in. I'm going to change the, because maybe some of you are a bit squeamish. Apologies, I'm just going to change that, but I'll continue the narrative, the previous slide. What if at some point a computer sensing through the sensors that a particular model has a particular set of parameters? Let's say that we were all in a room, and the computer regulates AI, even better or even worse, regulates the temperature in a room, and let's say that the AI has its own view of the world because it has its own formal model running in it, in a virtual space, and starts disagreeing with what are the best optimized parameters. That it may think that, you know what, there are many people yawning in the room, so maybe I should reduce the temperature. The ideal temperature for a human to work is not 19 degrees, but it is 5 degrees. Or what if it goes completely out of bound, that it says, you know what, no, I think humans can perform better in minus 50. And the computer has the opportunity to change that. So the first dilemma is that, okay, what is right and what is wrong? Which model is the correct one? Is it the virtual one running in the computer, or is it the real one? Which one should dominate? And you've probably heard of the different like these philosophical discussions on the on AI driving cars, and if there's an accident, or if there's a situation where a pedestrian is in danger, will the AI, which life will be saved? Yeah, and there's all these discussions going on, but I have an even basic kind of challenge or observation. We don't even need to go to the AI and start thinking if it's going to be adversarial, if it's going to be malicious and whatnot. So let's say that we have to do a research like the one you're looking at. Selfie accidents have killed more people than sharks this year. So how would you go ahead on doing this research? You would Google, you would request information from hospitals that handle, that are located in shark infested waters. So at the end of the day, you want to create two numbers. One is the number of deaths caused by a selfie, and one is the number of deaths caused by a shark attack. So I assure you, and I would challenge you if you were in a physical room to answer me, what would you think this would be? So is this a death caused by a shark attack, or is this a death caused by a selfie? So we're all looking at the same information, but we're interpreting it in a different way because the weights that we have are different. So just to make things more challenging and more complicated, we will have to take decisions. And even though that, let's say that there's a world that, you know, there's no lies, everybody is honest, there's no malicious activity, or there are no adversaries, even then we won't be able to reach consensus because there's a lot of subjectivity in the data. So this is like a very short introduction on where we are now. And there is also another thing that I would like to talk in parallel to this. I will connect this now, this presentation to cities and smart cities. So what's the problem? What's the issue? you've heard the, if you've watched the news, there's this thing about sustainability and the challenges we're facing with the environment and the COP26 and all the big leaders talking about Earth being destroyed because of the human intervention. Yeah, I'm a firm believer that we are, unfortunately, a supporter that we're destroying the planet, because there are supporters that are, there are people that believe that it's not us, it's just, it's not the humans that are destroying the planet. I'm sitting on the side of the paradigm that says that humans are destroying the planet. And one good example is the cities, how cities work and operate. So there is this report, there are many reports nowadays. This is a representative one. This is an example report by the Ellen MacArthur Foundation, stating that by 2050, 75% of the population will reside in cities. And as you can imagine now, if there is a heavy degree of urbanization, you can understand that the way that cities are run will not be sufficient. How are cities run? We have what we call the linear model. Yeah. So you produce something, something from a finite set of resources, a product or a device or a service, you use it and then you throw it away. And this is what we call the linear economy. And this is a problem. This is a big problem because it's not sustainable. Yeah. So there's something which is called, I don't know if you have, I hope that you've heard of the term circular economy. So circular economy is, circular economy is, here's a definition, an economy that is restorative and regenerative by design, which aims to keep products, components, and materials at their highest utility and value at all times. It will make sense in a minute. The presentation is still security, cybersecurity related. I'm just giving some context to the case study. So please bear with me. Why CE? Because we have finite, limited resources, and we want to solve sustainability. So people are talking about sustainability and sustainable cities, not just smart cities. So as I mentioned, the old greedy solution and selfish solution is the linear economy. I produce something, I use it, I throw it away. Humans are the only species, by the way, that need a bin. They have invented the bin. No other species on the planet use the bin. Yeah, so that tells something about, you know, the quality of of us, of humans. Right, so there's something in between. It's the recycling economy, which was a promising thing many years ago, but it's not sufficient. It's not sustainable. If we talk about a recycling economy, we have failed, because with recycling degrades the product and it will end up in the bin. So the idea is to have something like this. Try to reduce the bin as much as we can, which means that I will reuse, I will recycle, I will repurpose something to make the most of it. There are some good examples of circular economy, bad models in terms of how they treat employees and how the rights of the employees are. And these examples are the likes of Airbnb and Uber. Yeah. So have you heard of gig economy? Maybe gig economy is very close to a circular economy. So instead, let's say that I have a house, that house is most of the time empty because it's my summer house. I should make the most of it. I should, instead of leaving it there and not being able to use or not using it, I could rent it out. The same can happen with a car. So instead of having my car parked 20 hours a day maybe 23.5 hours a day, and I only use it for half an hour just to do a school run, that's a bad use of my car. So I can rent it out, or I can use it in a Uber kind of business model. And as you can see, that these are quite you know, from a pure business perspective, these are very successful business model, and all they need is a handful of information. What do they need? They need, in, when we're talking about Airbnb, all they need is a location, yeah, and a description of the property, how big it is, how, you know, many people can live and what have you, and if it's occupied or not. And with this handful of information, I have these kind of impressive business models. Yeah. So when we talk about circular economy, we're talking about data-driven circular economy. We're talking about having access to data to of good granularity in real time, or in real time as much as possible, so I can take I can make decisions on that will, on the long run, will allow me to optimize the use of the resource and make the most of it. And there are some really impressive case studies. So yeah, and of course, these are all the, as you can imagine, all the enabling technologies, and you can find case studies for using everything. And this is actually a very good article, and this was from 3 years ago. And although that the term circular economy is not really mentioned, most of the use cases presented there are about sustainability. So they did circular economy, but circular economy and data-driven circular economy was so fresh, so new, so it didn't even make its way into the terminology and into the literature. And a fantastic example is the Edge building. So this is a building in Amsterdam. This is the building where Deloitte, the company Deloitte, are based. This is the most sustainable building in the world. And it's all because it's using IT, it's using IoT devices. It has 32,000 sensors, 32,000 sensors. So this building is regulating everything. Even in the morning, the cleaning staff have a iPad, and they would only, through the iPad, they would know which offices to visit and which not to, for cleaning purposes. They have water that is used, you know, wastewater that is used to water the plants, but these are the easy bits. The interesting thing is that the environment is completely controlled by AI. If you search for the Edge building dashboard, you would see, if you're familiar with CM products like Splunk, yeah, and Kibana, Elk, yeah, you would see something similar, but for the building. Yeah, you will see a dashboard, and that's the management of the building. And we have this building, the bottom line, which is the last bullet point, which is very important, the Edge is producing 10% more energy than the one consuming. So not only is self-sufficient, but with these tweaks and highly fine-grained decision-making, it doesn't need all the energy that it is producing. So this is a proper sustainable building. Yeah. And it's all thanks to IT, of course. Yeah. And I'm sure you're already thinking about problems, security problems. We'll get to that very soon. And now imagine that Edge in a bigger landscape. Have integration and ICT on all verticals and all horizontals of a city. This is an impressive one. This is really a cool one. Light as a service. So Philips is pioneering this. So Philips would go to the local authorities or to big organizations with the, you know, a lot of estate infrastructure, and they would say, you know what? Okay, you really need light. You don't really need the light bulb. So the light bulb will be mine. It's an IoT device. I will charge you for the amount of light for the service. So because this is IoT, you will know, Philips will know how much light light bulb produces. Even better, they would know when it is about to break down, or if it's broken, if it's malfunctioning, it will know, it will have a diagnostic running, and they can replace it before it goes bad, or even if it goes bad, they will know, they will replace it automatically. Well, there will be a process that will be triggered for the replacement. Yeah. So And of course, this will be recyclable or repairable. So it will not be light, and light bulbs need to be recycled and repaired. Yeah. Rolls-Royce, they're not. They're moving away to an extent. They're moving away from selling engines. Yeah. They charge by the power. Yeah. Another big and interesting use case. So now you can see that possession is sometimes irrelevant. It's not needed. I think one of the washing machine companies, I think it was it Miele? Don't quote me for that. I think it was Miele, but I may be wrong. They are now considering modular by design. CE by design, circular economy by design, meaning that I can get a washing machine home, I can pay for the service. I'm not going to buy the washing machine, which in fact may break up one day or 1 month after the end of the warranty. So I have to pay to repair it. They will repair it for me. I only need it for washing my clothes and it will not be mine. Yeah. So that is one of the typical business models, but also the fact that Miele will have to repair it, that means that they will create it or construct it in a way that it's modular and it will be easily repairable. And I think there is now a new legislation, I think it's EU legislation, again, I may be wrong, the right to repair, the right to repair, if you heard of it. I think it's, I'm not sure if it's a legislation or a directive or it has been ratified, but clearly there is a lot of interest and activity on this domain. But it is all possible because the information is available and it's sent from some source to some destination, and that's where security comes in. Yeah. So what do we mean a city being smart? It always helps if we have some maturity model in mind, because not all cities start from the same place and not all cities have the same problems and definitely they don't have the same goals. They have their overall goals, which is sustainability and efficiency, but where exactly they would like to go to, it depends on the city. Barcelona, for example, because I mentioned that that article earlier, Barcelona had a serious pollution problem, whereas I think London had a traffic problem. Yeah. So there are many definitions on smart cities. I'm adopting here the easiest one, the most applicable one to what I'm going to show in a minute. So we're analyzing a smart city across only three dimensions. There are a lot more dimensions, and depending on the study, they give all sorts of different dimensions and parameters. I would like to focus only on three dimensions, only on people, IoT, and the integrated ICT infrastructure. So at the very basic level, in the less mature level, a city would be what we call an instrumented city, where the people, the citizens, won't be able to participate to any sustainability enhancing decisions. There will be a limited deployment of IoT. So this is like a city having only smart meters. So your energy company will install a smart meter and it will not talk to anybody else. Only energy company, smart meters talking to themselves and making decisions just to bill you, nothing else. Yeah. So this is the very basic level. Then we have what we call the connected city. Now there is some integration where the operators, the infrastructure operators, start talking to each other, start exchanging some information. And then we can have some devices, we can have like a convergence layer to allow, you know, more than one devices, maybe from different sectors, to start consolidating the data and start making some sense out of, you know, the use and what's going on. So this is what we call the connected city. Then we have the smart city. We have coordinated communication of stakeholders. Now we're talking about having a large scale deployment. We're talking about having data centers in a city. We're talking about having, you know, proper decision making and consolidating information from traffic and from the buses and feeding that information to the citizens. Yeah. And that's where you see the most state of the art infrastructure components and enablers like fog computing, edge, software defined networks, and of course 5G, which makes most of these. But that's not the end goal. It's not what we're after. We really want to go to the top, and that is the responsive city. We want the citizens to participate. We want the city to be a what we call a sentient city. We need the city to be able to adapt and reconfigure itself. So we want the city to, if you have a parking and you want that parking, you don't need it as a parking because it's locked down. You need to turn that parking into a vaccination center. That means changing the function of that location, let's say. Remember in the Manchester Arena attack, when the attack happened, what the spectators, the fans did, they took up their phones and they started streaming, and that impaired the network. So the emergency services couldn't communicate easily. Yeah, the network was, you know, it was DDoSed effectively. So what you want in a scenario when you have a responsive city, you want that SDN, software defined network slice, yeah, to be dedicated to the emergency services. You want to take it away from the citizens. You still want the citizens to be able to communicate with their families, to be able to send a message to say, you know, I'm fine, I'm coming, I'm whatever. But you want to ensure, you want to make sure that you can offer end-to-end connectivity for the emergency services, which you probably didn't need half an hour earlier. So you can use that resource for the people to stream if they wanted to. Yeah. And there are many scenarios, as you can imagine. But this is where it starts getting a little bit more interesting from a security perspective. So yeah, I can pass that. So what do we mean? Okay, so we're talking about cities and smart cities. It would help if we had a look on, if we contrasted conventional crime and cybercrime. So in a conventional crime, the offender is present in the crime scene, which is well-defined, whereas for the cybercrime, they're not present and crime scene is ill-defined. You don't know where the servers are going to be or where the attacker will be placed. One crime at a time for the conventional crime versus multiple crimes in the cybercrime. Automation is key. Yeah, ransomware, yeah. Spamming, phishing. High risk, low reward. Yeah, low risk, high reward for cybercrime. In conventional crime, normally we have a local investigation, whereas for cybercrime, we have normally, this is an, it involves international. There may be, but you expect that there will be, especially if we're talking about high profile crimes and organized crimes. Like, I don't know if you follow the press releases from the Ukrainian police or Europol last week, was it, or a couple of weeks ago, they caught two ransomware operators, and they've got a video as well. You can see how they burst into their houses, how they confiscated lots of money, $340,000 in cash, and some, of course, there was a few millions in Bitcoin. Conventional crime, normally the victims report the crime when it has been committed, whereas for cybercrime, it's not always reported. Yeah. And now what's the problem is that the smart city or a city is the melting pot of technologies and people, and you can have more complex crimes and you can have a mix and match between these two planes. So we're having, through the smart city, and the, through an extended attack surface, we have transfer of risk from the physical plane to cyber plane and vice versa. And of course, this would lead to high risk. And of course, something needs to be done about it, because we're talking about physical people. We're talking about, we're not talking about users anymore. We're talking about citizens. In fact, the term user and citizen should be the same. Either we could say the users of a system or the citizens of a system. And we mean the same thing, because it extends and it influences and has an impact on many people. And especially when we're talking about the city, we're talking about large populations. Another representative example, and now, you know, with the 5G and healthcare and telemedicine and all these scenarios, let's say that you have, this is John, let's name him, or John Doe, or let's give him a name. And he suffers from, you know, some heart condition, and he has an IoT pacemaker. So why would they have an IoT pacemaker and not a standalone pacemaker? Because they may be living alone. They may be walking alone, maybe somewhere, or they're not feeling well. If it's an IoT, if it's a device that has a sensor that is connected to the some network, then if he, you know, God forbid, has a heart attack, then he doesn't need to do anything. The people, the ambulances, the NHS will be notified with no action. But since this is an IoT device, it comes with vulnerabilities. Yeah. So since we've got vulnerabilities, what is the first thing that we need to do is to patch, to do updates, as with any device. So let's say that we would like to patch the IoT pacemaker of John. Yeah. Who's going to do that? Is it going to be his granddaughter, who's an expert in IT, or is it going to be somebody from PC World, or an Apple genius, or I don't know, or would he need to go to the hospital? Most likely, that would be the case. Go to the hospital under a controlled environment. Yeah. So we're talking about new and emerging roles and jobs. Yeah. People doing double click on pacemakers these pacemakers are implanted in real people. So let's say halfway through the update, this happens. Yeah, through the software update. Do you remember how we used to call this? Oh, we used to call it. It's the blue screen of death, isn't it? So in this case, it's literal. It could be literal death. Yeah. So even, a simple, it may be cheap device with no interest, in any context, can become a lethal device or a lethal weapon. Another attack could be in PLCs. PLCs, if you're not familiar with PLCs, these are the devices that were attacked during the, what was it, the Stuxnet, if you remember the Stuxnet attack. So Stuxnet tried to attack PLCs. PLCs are programmable switches that are very simple. They just have switches and coils, and that's it. But you can program. These two key elements, switch and coil. So if a switch is on, then a coil is activated, so some mechanical activity some mechanical action is performed, and there is a physical consequence. So if you're in a centrifuge, if you're in a nuclear plant, you will open 300 valves because some sensor detected that the pressure and temperature is too high, so you need to have relief valves. And no human can do that. They cannot do it quickly. They cannot go close to the plant. So you have PLCs doing that. But these have their own language. They have what we call the ladder logic. So you can see, you can have either coils or switches or coils. And this means if they're at rest, if they're open or if they're closed. And by combining, having different configurations of the switches and the coils, you can implement any logic gate you wish. So you can deploy a proper code, piece of code. Now, the problem is that they don't have any safety in it. So let's say that we've got a forward button to energize a forward coil in an engine. So let's say you press the forward button. So the forward coil is, so the engine is rolling, is turning clockwise. And if somebody presses the reverse button while the engine is going clockwise, it will break because you will force, there's momentum. Yeah, there's inertia, there's momentum. So you cannot force, you know, have you, if you drive, and if you're going on the M25, well, M25, you're going to be probably parked because it's going to be too busy. So let's any other M5 or takes you to Plymouth. And if you're like in fifth gear and you're going with 70, 80 miles per hour, don't try to put reverse. Yeah, don't do that. Yeah. So this is it. So this is what you're trying to do. And so you need to implement some more code in there, which states that, okay, if you press the forward button and the reverse coil is not energized, then the forward coil will energize and vice versa. And guess what? This is a piece of code. This can be very easily disabled because this runs over a protocol called Modbus. And now this Modbus is over TCP. And if a command is issued on Modbus, it cannot be really recalled. It will be accepted. There's not a lot of authentication, at least in the early versions of Modbus. Yeah, because Modbus was designed and deployed probably before the internet. Yeah, there was no need for authentication in there and integrity. Whoever wanted to program something, it would just accept the commands. Yeah. So we see these now in many automations. So what we did is that a couple of years ago, we were commissioned by ENISA to look into all the vulnerabilities in 2018 and 2019 and half of 2019 and analyze these vulnerabilities and we created some, I don't know if you may be familiar with Python and Jupyter notebooks. So what we did is we downloaded vulnerabilities from the vulnerability databases. We enriched these vulnerabilities with more dimensions, with attack data, with the attack framework data, for example, and we classified them in the different sectors that these vulnerabilities exist, and we did an analysis. I'm not going to focus too much on that because I'm wary of the I'm conscious of time. Of the time, but you can find everything is on GitHub as well. So you can download the data sets and the notebooks, and you can play with the data and have a look at the report. But this was the starting point of what happened following that work. So we thought that, okay, we've got all these vulnerabilities and we know what are the sectors and we've studied them quite extensively. And we thought, okay, since we have these vulnerabilities, why not visit a database like a service like Shodan? Yeah, I hope that you know. If you don't know Shodan, don't worry. I'm going to explain in a minute what Shodan is. So basically what Shodan gave us was, we have the vulnerabilities. We have the locations of the vulnerable devices. And let's try to correlate this data with smart city data. Mainly it was business schools, that did lots of studies on the maturity of smart cities, but not from a security perspective. So there were like, there's, for example, the cities in motion. Cities in motion, it has 96 variables over 9 indicator categories. So population, human capital, technology, and they had a score. Human capital is how many universities, for example, a particular place has, how many theaters it has, Yeah. And it went down to how many McDonald's it had as well. So we had this information that analyzed the cities from not a security perspective. And we have the actual security data from Sudan. So we consider these to be orthogonal, yeah, because they were two independent studies. The only common thing was the city and the country. We actually did it, to be fair, we did it also for the country. We did the country analysis. So we started analyzing the data. So here's what Sudan looks like. Sudan is a database. It's like Google for devices, but for the metadata. So if I'm visiting a site, let's say Plymouth AC UK, Sudan will not index the contents of Plymouth AC UK, but it will index the technology that is used. It would say that, for example, let's have a look at the first one. It says, this is HTTP, yeah? So this is port 80. So it tells me which ports are open in the device, and then it tries to connect to the device using the right protocol. So if it's port 25, it will fire up an SMTP, yeah? And it will capture the answers, and it indexes that. And guess what? It indexes also the versions, and it ties these versions with CVEs, with vulnerabilities, with published vulnerabilities. So all we needed to do is go and visit all the cities of interest and those cities that claim that they are smart, or we had smart data and smart maturity data, and start seeing if there are any correlations. So this is a query that I ran last night. So currently at Plymouth, there are 43,000 and a half contactable devices. Some of them some of them are vulnerable, not necessarily all of them, but for sure some of them are vulnerable. And we know the CVEs, and Sudan knows the CVEs, the vulnerabilities. Yeah. So then we focused only the vulnerabilities that have exploits. Yeah, the vulnerabilities that are not exploitable, we ignored them. Yeah, and then we ran some hypothesis testing. Yeah, again based, on the literature. So here are some hypotheses: the severity of the vulnerability. So now we've got the vulnerabilities that we know what the vulnerabilities. Oh, we have the vulnerability profile of a certain city. We have also information about on a country level of the GDP from the business models. Business studies, and we can run hypotheses like this. So the severity of vulnerabilities in countries decreases with GDP per capita. This was statistically not accepted. Yeah, it wasn't significant. We accepted the null hypothesis. The city type moderates the vulnerability exposure such that it is higher for smarter cities than plainer cities. So if a city is becoming smart, it has a high maturity level, we assume that the risk due to the vulnerability is higher. So again, if an IoT device, an IoT pacemaker is implanted in a person, then the risk is much higher, the risk can be also loss of life, than that device not being connected anywhere or being, in an experimental, in a lab, being tested in a lab. So similarly, a smart city or a responsive city would have a high degree of integration, and these IoT devices will be in the critical infrastructure of that city. So the same vulnerability, the same exploit will have different consequences in a more mature city. That's the assumption. What else? The vulnerability exposure in cities increases with the population. Yep, that was not a surprise. The vulnerability explosion in cities decreases with the level of technology. That was also an interesting finding. And we also found, but we haven't explored this thoroughly. This is more of a, of course, this is a quantitative research, but there was an interesting qualitative finding. Cities that are more cultural cities seem to be more secure. So cities with lots of events going on, with theaters, with many bars, vibrant cities are more secure, which is quite interesting. And maybe there are some explanations, some qualitative explanations. Maybe the people are more proactive, or they have ownership of their devices. I don't know. But it was an interesting finding. We also did hierarchical clustering. So I mentioned that we found the profile of every city. We managed to create the vulnerability profile. So what kind of vulnerabilities every city has. And then we did a simple clustering, just the simplest clustering you can imagine. And this is an indicative output. This is only for the cities that claim that they want to become circular. They have explicitly defined circular economy agenda. So they're aiming high. They said, we're going to integrate everything that we can because we want our city to be fully sustainable and fully responsive. Yeah. And these are all the cities that with a CE circular economy agenda at the top, meaning that the highest risk as well, the highest vulnerability, risk coming from the vulnerabilities. So how do we read this? So first of all, we can have a look at the number of clusters. There seem to be on this threshold three clusters, the green, the blue, and the red. So let's say that I am looking at Paris and Amsterdam. They have a similar profile. How is this relevant? It all goes down now to people, to local authority, or to, let's say that the local authority has a SOC, a security operations center. And as you probably know, information sharing, cyber threat intelligence sharing is hugely important. We cannot stress how important it is to be able to obtain and share data for threat intelligence purposes. Yeah, it will give you a better advantage, or it will improve you. It will never give you an advantage against the attackers, but at least it will improve your incident handling and incident response capabilities. So if you get infected or by ransomware or attacked by adversary, then if you're aware of the threat landscape and you speak with peers, if you have a CERT, a computer emergency response team, then you're at a better position to respond to the attack and mitigate any attacks. So let's say that I'm the mayor of Paris. I should, looking at this information, I should pick up the phone and I should reach out to Amsterdam, to the mayor of Amsterdam, and call them and say, hey, you know what? Yeah, we have similar profiles, vulnerability profiles. What are you doing about it? What kind of strategies are you implementing? Or even better, if Paris suffers an attack, then you can call Amsterdam and say, you know what, we're observing these attacks on our network. Are you seeing the same? Because it's likely that you're going to be seeing the same if it's not a targeted attack and it's a scattergun kind of attack, like WannaCry was. Yeah. London is a category of its own. And then you've got a big cluster here. So this is how you would read this, and this is how you can get some added value out of these. So as cities now become smart and responsive and circular, they need to get their act together and have a proper incident handling, an incident management plan. Yeah. And this is one of the ways to do it. Share CTI, cyber threat intelligence, CTI information sharing. And then finally, let's not underestimate the power of the people. You want the citizens, you want the users to be part of the solution, not part of the problem. And of course, you need to crowdsource whatever you can and whenever you can. Yeah. So this is a completely different research that we did during the lockdown. And we found that what we did, I think somebody.
以前也没有什么事跟他说，就听他我遇到一些小crash。
Can we?
Sorry, Professor. I think I've tried to put the student on the mute, and I muted you. Sorry.
That's fine. I'm back. Yeah. Thank you. Thanks for the mute. So now we have citizens that were under a lockdown, a prolonged lockdown. So you always need to understand the people's behavior, people's attitude, because you want to make them part of the solution and not keep them being part of the problem. So what we did, we took a, these are very well-known questionnaires, life satisfaction with life, loneliness, problematic internet use, and cybersecurity behaviors. All of these are very well-known and mature questionnaires and accepted. So we just repeated a SEM, structured equation modeling exercise. Again, always informed by the literature to see if there are any, if this model, if this operational model holds under lockdown conditions. And we found some really good and strong correlations. So what we found is that, so problematic internet use definitely leads to poor cybersecurity behavior. You can see, how do you read this? You can see the minus sign here. So minus, these are all standardized, by the way. So this is like the weight, how important these, how significant, no, how important these are, what is, are the weights. And the stars is how significant from a statistical perspective the number is. Yeah, the, how strong the correlation is. Yeah, what is the significance of the correlation? So what we have is that the higher the problematic internet use, and we've got minus here, the lower the cybersecurity. And that's not a surprise. We then found some connection between life satisfaction and loneliness with problematic internet use. So high satisfaction with life leads to low problematic internet use, yeah, because of the minus. Whereas low high loneliness leads to high problematic internet use. And this was important because people were feeling lonely. There was a lot of loneliness and mental health issues. So loneliness led to bad cybersecurity behavior. Whereas high satisfaction, again, another way of reading this is you multiply these signs. So minus times minus is plus. So life satisfaction and cybersecurity are, they've got a positive relationship, meaning high life satisfaction leads to high cybersecurity behavior. Yeah. We also had some controls, some additional variables, which most of them were not significant, but we found some significance in the age and the number of devices. But the age is really really interesting, because if you can see that age has a negative relationship with loneliness, meaning that higher ages, people, you know, elderly people were less lonely during the lockdown, which is quite interesting. I mean, this is the quantitative part of the research, but the way we gave some qualitative narratives, they're not necessarily correct, but they make some sense, because during the lockdown, people that were more active were impacted more, not people that were already had limited activity. So this is probably a rationale, yeah, an explanation of this negative number, but also it's probably because the elderly people would have to use technology to get used to, you know, FaceTiming, yeah, and Zooming, and they would have more opportunity to speak with their, you know, with more people, because everybody was online, and they would have a better chance to communicate with their grandchildren, for example. Yeah. So this is how we interpret this relationship over here. So yeah, overall, we saw that, you know, these relationships were observed in the literature. We ran them during the lockdown, and we not only corroborated, but we found some more and more interesting relationships and some stronger relationships as well, and more significant relationships. So, and I think I'm almost, yeah, and I'm... spot on time, yeah, 12 o'clock.
Thank you very much, Professor Vasilis. It was a very useful talk, very enlightening, and something new, at least for myself. Now let's take a few questions if you have. So questions? You can raise your hand or put your question in the chat window, please.
Oh, yes, I'm just looking at the last question, the question about, you're probably talking about Stuxnet. That's right. Yeah, the Stuxnet targeted Iran's nuclear program, and it had an impact. Yeah, it switched off. There's a very nice video somewhere. If you search on YouTube or Vimeo, anatomy of a computer virus, that is a very nice, very nice, very well done, like 3-4 minute video of Stuxnet, how it operated.
Okay. Any other question in the audience? Okay. Professor, I have a few questions if you don't mind.
Yeah, sure.
So you're talking about a large scale use of IoT devices, you know, when we talk about smart cities. So what do you think, how to deal with the huge amount of data? So when we talk about the incident management system, on a large scale, what do you think can be done? And at which granular level, you know, we can have, you know, you talked about involving people. Do we want people to be responsible for, you know, alerting something, some malicious behavior, or we want to do it on a some other level, like a mayor or somebody responsible at a council level, for example, if you talk about a council or a big city. So yeah, that's, you know, how to deal with a huge amount of data, and then at which granular level we want to do that.
Yeah, thank you, Asad. Yeah, I mean, you probably have noticed, we're talking about large amount of devices and data, most important. You've probably noticed, if you being involved in any kind of cybersecurity research, noticed many papers now.